Hello, everybody. If it's Wednesday, it's Warhammer. That's right. We're back. Normal day. Normal time. What's going on? The world has gone crazy. Here we are, back again. It's Warhammer Weekly. Joining me, as always, is my own little scarab swarm. It's Tom. How you doing?
Hey, everybody. Welcome.
Tom isn't really a person. He's just a big bundle of scarabs in riding around in a little fake human skin. That's right.
Like Prince Khufu or Apopos. There we go.
Yeah, scary, right? And of course I bring up the Tomb Kings because also joining us is, I would say, one of the greatest tomb princes, still undead or alive or half-living or whatever. It's Tyler Mingle of Mingle Minis. How you doing, sir?
Hey, doing good.
It is a pleasure to have you back on the show. It was good to meet up with you at AdeptCon. I got to see your amazing Tomb King force in person. And let me just talk for a moment. I don't want to distract us too much. But here's what I love about Tyler's force at AdeptCon. Here is a man who not only ran Cetra, but also who made people fear skeleton spearmen. All right? There was just people, opponent after opponent, I would talk to them after the game, and they'd be like, "Those skeleton spearmen were crazy," because they would think they were nothing. And then what would happen? In comes 90 attack spearmen, you know, just 90 attacks at like 2 up, 3 up, or something, right?
Yeah, with all the buffs, pretty much just a giant delete button for at least one turn.
You do not know fear until that horde of the restless dead, yes, come over the sand dune and just wipe out your force, whatever it is. It's pretty fantastic. Many more far seemingly superior troops fell to their wake, that is for sure. All right, but of course we're going to start off with the news. So Tommy, what do we got this week?
We have actually a fairly light week this week. We had one... some clarifications on the Elven stuff coming out, or just the stuff that's dropping this summer. So for the Commander's Book, we know that there are going to be 6 scenarios there, and we'll be talking about scenarios later, so this should be interesting. Though in the book, there'll be points for everything, including Tomb Kings, and one has to assume the Bretonians. The cost, they're saying, is 20 euros, and it's in the book, supposedly, is fairly large. We're looking at, they said, the end of June or July. So it's not a lot different than what we've heard so far. The clarification on Alariel, Alariel isn't, like, her model has a giant beetle, but she's not on the giant beetle. She's actually hovering or flying above it. And the total model size, they're saying, is about the size of Nagash.
All right, so let me jump in here. So yeah. Is what we're all picturing, and I am picturing an Archaon-sized base, giant beetle walking forward, and then her up on a bunch of flowy, hippy-dippy robes that are actually the part that's attached to the beetle. And then she's still pretty much, like, I bet she's going to be slightly larger, but still mostly elf-sized, and just be, like, way up in the air. That's my prediction. What do you think? Right, or is she going to be huge?
I think she's going to be, like, ogre-sized, probably.
Yeah.
So, bigger than an elf, smaller than, like, Nagash.
I think she's going to be Stormcast Eternal-sized.
That's ogre.
And so, like, I know.
See, you say that as a negative. I say that as a positive. I don't see. Look at Lord Tremendous using Stormcast as ogres. It's a perfect fit. Continue.
I see it as the new normal. And I suspect that it's not going to be cloaks necessarily. I think it'll probably be like swirly magic things, and it'll be like. Maybe we may even see like the beetle sorceled in some way by flowy magic stuff like swirling around it. I don't know if that's the case, obviously, but I would not be surprised if that's the way they went. Kind of like the tendrils of magic that we see Nagash hovering on.
Sure, you know I know you're all about this size creep, and I don't want to distract us from the news, but I would just like to point out that these boys right here, the Zangor out of Warhammer Quest, these are exactly the same size as the old Gore Beastmen. Exactly. If you put them next to each other, they are exactly the same size and scale. So, I don't know about your new normal, but anyway, continue.
Okay. Don't make me get out that witch hunter and slaughter priest image.
It's just a question of normal. That's all. Go ahead.
The slaughter priest would be big, though. That's his whole thing. He's supposed to be a really big guy.
Yes. In his backstory, he gets all big.
Yeah. And the warrior priest that came in the Warhammer quest box, he's really big, too.
Yeah.
Then the white dwarf, they even mentioned, like, oh, he's really big. I wonder what that's about. So I think that's...
Yeah, like, he's a 7 foot. Like, yes, they said, like, they're imagining him being, like, a very large... But I'm just... But, like, you know what that says to me? That's the explanation as we're transitioning to the new scale. Is this guy's just inordinately large, and then in 5 years, we're like, oh, this is just normal. As everybody's that size. And everybody else looks like... Okay. Anyways, let's move on. So a new set of collecting boxes are coming for AOS. So this was the interesting rumor that dropped this week. They're saying around €20, which is really hard to believe. So we're talking like $25 USD for a ready-to-play set, which is like 5-on-5. So like a unit of 5 Liberators versus a unit of 5 Blood Warriors. I don't even know how to respond to this. Like, does that sound legit?
Yes, it does. It totally sounds legit.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
It's the, perfect. The starter set minis.
Exactly. Like, when I look at it, yes, let's go back to the financial report last year, right?
Yeah.
With the new CEO.
No, that's true.
What was their key point? We're going to offer more minis at more price points. That means high... Mm-hmm. And low, like they're gonna cover the spread, and that you like, they just showed
and
it with
people
the
are building factions. Like it forces people to build factions at the same time.
Yeah, and like they showed the they like consider the Star Collecting boxes. You got like big, crazy, expensive minis, Archaon, right? You've got these new combined like Lord Heldraths, whatever thing, which are good deals with some good percentage off. It's still fairly expensive, but it's a crap ton of minis, right? And then you got, like, the Star Collecting boxes. We've had the Warhammer Quest, which was, you know, basically $3 a mini for some great minis. So it's just all over the board. You got $40 clan packs for a single character. You know, sure. And then you got a $55 box that's, like, for those heroes that used to be 30, that were 30 and 40 apiece. I think the key is that, like, these will be very limited, right? You're not going to see, like, these little Star Collecting boxes won't be just packs of everything. It's going to be very specific in what it is, right? Which is good. It'll probably be stuff like they mentioned, Liberators and Blood Warriors. Okay, great. So it's the backbone of your force, theoretically, right? So you can fluff up those forces. Or maybe go halvesies with a friend. $12.50 a piece. There you go. So, sure. Because that's about 25 US probably, or 30 US, something around there.
Sure. So, yep. That dropped. It's interesting. We'll see. We'll see if they have any other factions other than Khorne and Stormcast, which is not real likely. I suspect that it'll be limited. So, what else do we have? Age of Sigmar, the open day. It's coming August 13th. Get your tickets now. It's being held at Warhammer World. And there's going to be a ton of stuff to see and do. There'll be a Golden Demon contest there, obviously. That's going to reveal their new detailed diorama display. So the thing that we had kind of seen pictures of on Facebook that we talked about, like, is that really the scale? It seems like they're talking about it's a, like, what did they say, 8x12-foot table? Like a diorama?
Yeah.
So it's going to be redonk. So looking forward to that. The other thing was that they talked about new Warhammer Forge models are coming, and they will be previewed there.
Awesome.
So that's kind of exciting.
Like, are we talking like the new, you're talking like the dragon or like the Femur or something are going to be there, that kind of stuff? Or they don't know?
They didn't say that. They just said, literally verbatim in the announcement, it said, get ahead of the crowd with access to new Warhammer Forge models before they're released.
I want to see the pics of that Chaos Dragon.
The Khorne Dragon. The Khorne Dragon.
Yeah. I'm excited about that guy. I also like the Femur. Where's that going? Are we going to get a new Femur force at some point in time from Forge World? Is this coming back? Is this relic of the 90s going to creep its way back into the Age of Sigmar completely through Forge World? Tyler, did you ever collect Femir? Did you ever have a Hero Quest box set and have some Femir in them? Because that's where I knew him from before I knew him as the minis.
Yeah, nope. I like them, though. I always like the Forge World ones. I mean, this is AOS is the perfect setting to bring in the small, highly odd force like that doesn't really fit in anywhere. So.
Yeah, absolutely. We don't need a whole army, right? We'd need, like, 5-6 War Scrolls, a couple characters, a couple dudes. It's fine. Whatever, we're good. And you could just have your own force. I would just laugh to no end if this is the thing that resurrects Femir after all this time. All right, man. I'm ready for
there
it.
Was a rumor, there was a rumor that, like, and this one's been floating around for a while, Bretonians are going to see a resurrection through Forge World. I don't know if that's actually going to happen or not, but I've heard it crop up on a couple different occasions. So, on a couple different forums.
Bretonia, like Cold Fusion, is the army of tomorrow, and it always will be. Like, it is just the undying rumor. It mirrors Bretonia itself. Like, Bretonia is the land of hope against all odds, right? That's what it's just a bunch of dudes in armor on horses fighting against the worst of the worst demons and everything in the universe. But they survive through, like, chivalry and hope and honor. It's the same thing with the actual players of the game. We survive just by believing that, yep, tomorrow the new Bretonian release is coming. Yeah, sure, yeah. Why not? I'll believe it.
My theory is that the Games Workshop HQ, they have one specific room under lock and key, and inside of it is all the new Bretonians, Sisters of Battle, the next Chaos Space Marine Codex, and all the other Greater Demons. Just keep it locked up. No one can go in there.
There's also the all-human, like the living Tomb King army is also already in there, so that's nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, we need like a Mission Impossible style thing. We gotta like hire, you know, Tom Cruise to like rappel in from the ceiling and get in there and just start stealing stuff. All right, I like it. Do we have anything else, Tom?
Yeah, just two brief things. One, there is a rumor. This might be a Warhammer Weekly exclusive. I'm not sure. That Age of Sigmar bases, just like the basing kit came for 40K. Now there may be Age of Sigmar bases coming with bits and pieces that we've seen from the new table, the Realm of Battle board that is still not released that we anticipated we would have by now. So, that's coming.
What I really want to see isn't just the bases. Like, that'd be cool. Don't get me wrong. I would love some more scenic bases. Like I said, there's a lot of companies out there doing it, so that's fine, whatever. But what I would love to see that I think is the real value is, like, the basing kit, like they did for 40K, right? Like, the 40K one has, like, sewer grates and lampposts and just, you know, detritus and stuff to sort of make your base more visually interesting. I'd love to see that kind of thing for Age of Sigmar. I think that would be pretty sweet. You know what they could do? Oh, go ahead, Tyler. Go ahead.
I'd say the one thing I've always wanted from them is just a clan pack. This is a sprue of skulls, plastic skulls. They have it on all their bases for all their studio armies. And the only way that we can get them is by buying, like, 40 boxes of Vampire Account skeletons and just using the heads.
It's funny that you're saying that. Because that's exactly where I was going. I was like, you know, they need more skulls in those clan packs.
Yep.
Here's my suggestion, okay? The skulls is good, but here's my idea. You know how, like, every mini for the past, like, 3 years has come Captain Morgan style with, like, their foot up on a rock or, like, a little arched piece of rock or something. I just want a basing kit that's just all of those rocks. Just all of the rests stolen and put into one kit. That way, because that's all I do with them. Every time I get a mini with, like, the Captain Morgan footrest, I cut that thing off and put it into my, like, bits box for use as scenic basing later. Because it always looks dumb. So there you go. Just save me the trouble. Make a kit with all the footrests. Just call it the Captain Morgan base expansion pack, and I'm down. All right.
Okay, and then finally, for those of you guys that have been following the Raging Heroes' CGG2, we've had a flurry of updates this last week, and it looks like within the next 6 days, they are going to close down the expanded pledging and open the pledge manager. For those interested, you can still technically get in. You can pledge. They They should be shipping within this next month, hypothetically. And some of the new sculpts dropped in these updates, and they are bonkers, as Vince is showing right now. It's just over the top. So these are some of the not safe for work minis. Thanks, Vince, for making our show NA17. But scroll down to the sisters. We don't care about these Slaanesh like dancers.
The weird Slaaneshi dancer chicks. Yeah, with the multiple arms. Agreed. Yes. Let's get to the good stuff. Oh my goodness, so many. Here we go. Now we're rocking and rolling.
Open up that top one. Like open up the
this one.
There we go. This is the good stuff. Whoa. That is huge. These sisters are going to be off the hook. So I am completely and utterly doing, I have a huge, huge block of these girls coming, and I'm going to use them as Stormcast Eternal proxies and do them as Sisters of Sigmar. So do all their gold, their armor in gold, and have the whitish brown cloth and the blues, and it's going to be hot. It's going to be so awesome.
I'm pretty beyond excited for this group of minis. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, so anyways, and so they have, for those interested, they have a Slaanesh, like, they call them Lust Elves, but Slaanesh Elves. They have normal Dark Elves, and they have these, like, Sisters of Battle, both, they have fantasy and sci-fi, both these, but these are, like, basically the Sisters of Sigmar style. They're fantastic. They have angels and a bunch of other troops. So, for those interested, you got less than a week to jump on it. By the way, shipping is going to be flat rate, so between $22 and $28, no matter how large your order is. So that's pretty awesome for those that went in deep on this this Kickstarter. So.
It's not as awesome if you backed for like one mini.
also that, true.
That $15 mini is going to run you a little bit more.
But that's not the case with me.
Of course. Yeah, absolutely. All right. Tyler, have you seen those before?
Yeah, I've seen. I don't think I've seen those ones, but I've seen the whole Toughest Girls in the Galaxy thing. And you start with the Sisters of Battle proxy and stuff.
Yep. Yeah, I'm pretty excited. That's my next big project. I'm just hoping to get. All I want is to get this stuff done before, like the Warhammer Quest stuff done, before we get in. Before I get that all arrives at my doorstep. That's my goal. Just gotta. It's gonna be once I get through like the things I really care about. It's going to be airbrush time. Like, pink horrors, blue horrors. Sorry, guys. It's going to be Zenithal and some color. That's what's happening to you. You're not getting the treatment. All right. So, I think that's all our news, right, Tom?
Yeah, I think so.
All right. Good. Pick of the week. Pick of the week. So, this is where we share a certain blog or video or something like that that we want you to check out. Last week was notable because Tom shared the first thing ever that I was interested in watching. I didn't watch it, but I was interested, and I think that's a landmark. So, Tyler, you're the guest. You get to start us off, man. What do you got for us today?
Well, it actually just came out yesterday, I think, but it's the newest Heel and Hammer episode. He's got an interview with Gav Thorpe on there. The whole episode is basically an interview with Gav Thorpe. It's just really interesting. He talks about his time in the design studio, how he started out with Games Workshop, moved through it. A lot about when he first heard about AOS and the end of Warhammer and how that was all handled behind scenes with the authors. It's just a really interesting interview.
That's awesome. Because I would love to hear his sort of background thoughts on that. That's pretty fascinating. I haven't listened to the latest episode yet, so that's good. I will definitely check that. I try to stay current on everything Heelan does because obviously it's all top-notch stuff, and that's probably a fantastic interview. What was his general reaction when he heard about everything? Give us a little spoiler, a little tidbit. Do you remember anything specific he said?
Yeah, well, so like the first he heard about Warhammer ending is because they brought him in to work on the End Times novel series, so they kind of had to tell him it's ending. But they didn't know what was going to happen beyond that. And then a while down the way, they started bringing in the authors. And they brought him and David Geimer in at the same time. And this kind of showed them at that point the early mock-up of the starter set and all the books and what the general gist of AOS was going to be. I mean, from what I can remember, he wasn't like shocked or anything. He knew something was going to happen because he knew it was ending. And it's just kind of, he talks a lot about, though, how writing for AOS now, he's got to kind of like shake a lot of his old habits for all the stuff he has from, you know, 20 years of Warhammer Fantasy.
Interesting. Yeah, I'll bet it's a big shift.
Space
Marine absolutely.
Stuff. Yeah.
All right. Good. I will link. I'm sure everybody knows Heel and Hammer. If you don't, what are you doing? Give that a subscription. But I'll, of course, link the show down below. All the things that we talk about in this section will be linked. Tom, what do you got? Picks of the week, buddy.
So I've chosen this pick before, but I'm going to push it again with a new spin. For those of you guys that don't know, there's a new community that's showed up in the last month or so called the Grand Alliance Community, which is a new Age of Sigmar forum. I want to encourage you guys to check it out. We actually have a home, our own forum home in the YouTubers section, us and just Morehammer, so that's it. So if you guys, and I'm on there fairly regularly, just kind of seeing and interacting with people, and so if you want to drop us a line or interact with us or ask questions or give us ideas for shows, you are welcome to drop in and do all of those things. So we will be there, or at least I will. I can't promise Vince will, because he's a terrible person. But other than that, I'll be on PGA and drop in and say hi. And yeah, I look forward to interacting with people.
Totally awesome. I love it. And yes, Tom will be there interacting. Me, I'll try. I make no promises. I got a lot of models to paint, folks. All right, like, and it's hard. I can't surf forums. If I can get somebody to read it to me.
Whoa. You have a lot of models to paint?
Yeah.
One of us has more models than the other to paint. But I still make time for our community.
Well, I appreciate that. I really do. That's why I hired you for this, Tom. You're my community forum manager. You didn't know that was in the title when I brought you on board and paid you the lavish sum of $0. Tell you what, you've been great. Double your paycheck. That's what I'll say. Just
wow.
Straight out double.
Thanks,
it.
Buddy.
Here for you. I have several picks of the week this week, all related to some different things. I'm just going to kind of fly through things. They're all small. The first thing I want to point out is, for those interested in other ranges of miniatures, if you happen to be a Ninth Age player or something like that, I Once Bitten made a video about a new company supporting the Ninth Age with some really cool miniatures. And what's interesting is, and what I found particularly relevant, is the first line of miniatures that they are making is a bunch of stuff for the Undying Legion, so basically Tomb Kings models. So they made a new, like, a new Tomb Prince, and there's some new knights and stuff. It's really cool. I'll link the video where OB walks you through it. He actually shows you, like, the concept art. He shows you what the sort of test sculpt looked like and all that kind of stuff. So it's very cool. So whether you're a Ninth Age player or you just want to get some different miniatures, you know, for your Tomb Kings because you missed out on getting them, you know, since they got discontinued, and you want to use them for AOS, or both, or you want to use them as dead people in Kings of War, or whatever. They look like a very promising line of miniatures for that, and I am always thrilled whenever I see more companies making Egyptian Undead, so I definitely want to throw that out there. I'll put the link down to Obi's video, and he's got the link out to their site, and I think some of the stuff is actually, in fact, I know, some of the stuff's available for order now, and then there's a lot more on the way. So, very cool stuff there. The second thing I would like to do is, we all remember the Oryx, and we all remember the yellow paint job, right? And a lot of people, I think the Oryx were very successful. I think in the end, a lot of people loved them. But I still think there was some question about how good they could look. And I thought I just wanted to share a mini that showed up on Putty and Paint, which is a fantastic website to surf if you want to really. So here is Christian Hardy's Fire Realm Megaboss, which, as you can see, is currently standing at a gold. Like, that is an insanely high score on this site, let me just say that. And this is just so unbelievably impressive work. I'll just kind of scroll through here. Tyler, had you seen this one yet?
Yeah, I'm actually was going to fit him in as my mini of the week at some point, but I just did a Megaboss by Aiden Daly of the Heavy Metal team, so I didn't want to do two Oryx right in a row.
Sure,
but yeah,
sure.
This guy's amazing. I love the lighting effect on it.
Absolutely. It's so subtle in some places and so well-defined in others, right? Like here, how bright it is versus the just very slight color up and under here, like under that ridge of the armor, right? Just these 1,000 little touches. I love the back tattoo as well. Like this sort of, like, think about this. He did this whole tattoo and then put the armor down on him and covered up most of his good work. But you know, if I took that armor plate off, there's going to be a whole finished tattoo under there. Like, that's not, there's no shortcutting on this, I would guess. So just absolutely stunning work from Christian. And, you know, check it out. Check out Putty and Paint. It's super fantastic. And honestly, it's very inspirational. Like, all joking aside about inferiority, I surf it a lot and find it extremely inspirational for just color schemes and the way to color balance and to think about blends and to think about other minis to explore and paint and stuff like that. It's really pretty fantastic. My last pick of the week is my comedy pick, okay? And I would like to so everybody is aware that GW makes sand, right? I have some, like the basing kit of sand. We all know what I'm talking about, yeah?
Yep.
Yes? All right. So I would like to direct everybody, and I'll include a link so you can read this or share it. I'm going to screen share an Amazon review of the GW sand because it's one of the funniest things I've ever read. I will read it verbatim. This sand is awesome. It is the best sand. It is the Uber sand. Most experienced modelers will know this already. How beautifully ground it is. How beige. How dry. This is the sand above all others. It is platonically perfect sand. It is the essential sand of which all other sands are but a corruption. It is not sand. It is sand. It is the sand, and it is. Do not be afraid of the price of the sand. Only this sand has probably been hand-polished by Horus until it glitters like stars in the desert sky. That common, boring sand that's lying around in free heaps all over the world, that is false sand for peasants. This sand is the king of all sands. So, look.
In conclusion, hold on. This is really good sand.
Correct. So there you go. That's my comedy pick of the week. If anybody wants to know what my sense of humor truly is, like what makes me laugh, that makes me laugh. That is my exact sense of humor. I probably laughed for 10 minutes when I read that originally, and I was like, all right, I've got to share this. So hopefully you found that as funny as I did. All right. False sand for peasants. All right, at any rate, let's get on to some hobby time. Tyler, what are you working on, buddy?
Warhammer Quest. Right now, yes. I'm working on the Zangors, just trying to do them all at once, which I'm really bad at batch painting. It's kind of like I have to force myself to batch paint stuff because I don't want to do it. So I'm trying to do all of them at the same time, and I do all the blue horrors at the same time. And I just want to knock out all the bad guys, but still look good. It's a struggle finding, like, for me, right now I think I just finished the skin on the first one of them, but I want to go in and do more highlights, and I have to stop myself from doing it because I don't have the time to do that many highlights on 51 models, so.
Sure. You're like, let me just do a few more. Maybe just a little more. Yeah.
Yeah, that's how my test model always ends up being like 10 times better than the rest of the group. I do the test model and I do it all out, and then I get to the other 9 of them. They're fine.
It's funny because I assume that's going to be a common thing. I'm willing to bet the hobby time on this show for a couple weeks to come is going to be like a lot of people working on Warhammer Quest, just because it's everywhere. I worsened my problem. I went out and bought from like a bit site. I bought another pack of Zangor because I love them so much. I'll probably get another pack of them as well at some point. One, because I want to use part of them for competition, and two, because I love the models and want to use them in my actual Beastman army.
I'm debating about buying some more of the Acolytes so I can paint some up the game and paint some up for my Tomb Kings. Because,
yes.
I mean, they look Tomb King.
Totally.
I love it, yes. I'm pretty sure from the bit sites now, you can get, like, the 8-packs of those guys, you know, like, because they come in 8 in the box or whatever.
They're pretty cheap.
Yeah. I love how,
it's like, $12.
Yeah.
The prices have been holding pretty steady. Kerak Acolytes are sitting around $17 or $18 for the 8 of them. The Zangor are fluctuating between $15 and $20. And most of the heroes are at around $10 right now.
So there you go. I have seriously thought about picking up a couple more of those Dark Oath Chieftains. That's the other one that I could do with a couple of those. Like, one to do really nice, and then a couple others that I can just still do nice, but I want to, like, hack them up. You know, like, do some conversions on them, because I think they're good fodder for a lot of different, like, Chaos Marauder-style heroes, right? Like, just old-school kind of, like, conqueror, you know, from the Northern Wastes Chaos heroes. I think they'd be excellent. They're just conversion ready, I think.
I've sold off a bunch of sets, and so I have a bunch of these extra, and I kept one of the chieftains for like my lord guy that sits on top of the War Mammoth. So it's the Marauder leader that's not a hero, but sort of my War Mammoth conversion. So and he has that, like, perfectly smug look and stance. It'll just be perfect on top of the howdah.
Yeah, I saw somebody who converted it to be the cover image. Like, they took the sword that's down in this angle, and they like, flipped the arm and hand all around. So it's, like, the cover where he's kind of, you know, splayed like this, like, about to fight. It was a nice-looking version. Didn't look that hard. A little bit of green stuff and a couple of joints, but other than that, pretty straightforward. All right. Tom, I know what you're working on. Would you like me to share what you're working on?
Actually, hold on. I actually have been working on my Silver Tower stuff as well, my Warhammer Quest. I've been working on basing stuff right now for them in between this other project that you're going to share. This is, like, way not done, but I just have some base, like, flesh tones, and there's a lot of detail work, obviously, that has not been touched on this yet, but I am working on, as you guys know, my Glotkin. And so he's getting there. I have tons of detail work. I've actually made a lot of progress since this picture on his, like, pustules and stuff like that, in which, like, here it doesn't look like there's a lot, but I probably painted 150 pustules already at this point. It is over the top. There is so much pustules. So I'm doing well on this guy, and he's coming along. So I'm happy with him. It's a great model. Like, as terrible as it is, it's been a really interesting model to paint. Yeah, that's what I'm working on.
Gross. Awful. No, you're doing a good job. It's just a hideous model. But you're doing a good job. All right, at any rate. And I am working on, Warhammer Quest as well. I'm working on some Zangor. This is going to be my... this is going to be like a competition unit. I'm going to do like 4 of these guys up for competition, probably led by the Gaunt Summoner. And I like how this guy's coming along. He's based off of, this was my test. That was how that guy from last week came out. And then so this will be these guys will be the new ones.
We can't see that at all.
I know. I'm sure it's all crappy, but whatever. Stop messing with me. There you go. There he is. There. Zangor. Okay. You can see him, yes? Bird people. All right, great. Done. I've also been playing. You know what I love right now? I love the 100 different ways that we're all trying to duplicate Warhammer Quest bases. Right? This is what I'm seeing on Twitter. Yeah. Is 100 people trying different ways to duplicate the effect of the Warhammer Quest board in base form. So, Tyler, what have you been doing for your bases on this?
Feeling bad that mine aren't going to look as nice as all these ones people are doing on Twitter. I just don't know if I can put that much effort into them.
I tried...
I'm pretty sure...
Oh, good.
Sand. I'm pretty sure I'm just going to do sand and paint it, you know, like a cave or something. I don't know. Lazy way out.
I saw... The most clever one I saw was somebody scanned the game board. Okay.
Yeah.
And then... just printed it off like on a high color photo, like on a, you know, on a photo printer, like a color photo printer, and then just sliced it to match the base, right? And so just put the models on top of that. I thought that was pretty darn clever. I liked that. But I've seen, like, on my Warrior Priest, I tried, like, the plastic art thing.
Did they at least, like, lacquer it? Did they at least, like, lacquer it or find some way to, like, protect the print?
Yeah, I'm sure they probably
I think they said they were going to.
I think they just gloss varnished it, which would make sense. Like the game board itself has a shininess, right? So it would look appropriate. Yeah, I am interested. Put it down below if you've seen a cool image of somebody doing some Worm Request bases. I've been experimenting with a couple different ways. Ironically, in screwing around with stuff, I found a way to do something with Martian Iron Earth that I have never been able to. I found a new way to use Martian Iron Earth, the crack base, like the Mars crack base. Okay, I found a way to achieve a really insanely cool effect. So I'm gonna play with that and probably do a hobby cheating video out of it. It was complete accident. Like I'm just screwing with stuff and it came up. So I was like, all right, give that a shot. So I'll put together a video of it because I think what I'm gonna be able to do with it is make hyper cracked ice bases. So like not ice lake like my Zinch army, but like if you want to be on broken shredded ice, I think I can duplicate that really easily.
You know what you should do is do get one of the Doom Bowls or one of the big minis that seems to be like stomping into the ground and then ice crack around where their foot is.
Yes, you could do that, I believe, pretty easily with this method. Yep. And I did that some on my Zinch bases. I just drew in the crack lines, right? And then...
Right.
Wasn't as heavy. Okay. Anywho. By the way, the Q&A is on. So if you've got any questions, feel free to pop them in as we move into our feature segment. So this week, we are talking about scenarios. And there's a reason I wanted to talk scenarios with Tyler. And that is because this man is leading the pack when it comes to developing scenarios and fluff and all sorts of more stuff for AOS through a new site that he put up. So Tyler, you want to share the site because I'll lock on you and you can share up what you've got and you can talk about it.
All right. Let me know when you can see the site.
Yes, I can. Endless Deserts. All
right. Yep. So the Endless Deserts. So it's a site I put together. Basically, I've been creating all this stuff for AOS, either directly for Tomb Kings or related to Tomb Kings or somewhat related to Tomb Kings, through Mangle Miniatures, my main site. And I posted up there, and I kind of collected it onto a random page there, but I didn't think it was very easy for people to find. And then I made my army list for Adepticon this year had a lot of effort put into it with imagery, design, logos, and background and all that. And so I wanted an easy way for people to get that too. So I decided to make a new website that's just going to kind of act as a home for all the stuff that I make and that other people make. So that's where the Endless Deserts website came from. So I worked on this for about like 2 months, two to three months maybe, on and off. And the basic intro page, but it's got a page about, what is this website about. It kind of talks about, why I made this, basically everything I just said. But then it's also got a bunch of lore, a bunch of rules, several books or book-related things, some galleries, I went through and collected all my tutorials I've done related to Tomb Kings. A map. Forums was actually a sub-forum on the TGA community that Ben Curry made for me. And then some contact info. So I'll just go through some of this really quick. So breeze through some of the lore pages. I've got, you know, a whole page going over what are the endless deserts within Shayesh. And then just kind of the background I made for the whole area, which this all started with the things I had made for my Adepticon list, which was the Endless Deserts. Basically just talking about the Tomb Kings here, and then a little bit about my own Tomb King, Farrakh. So this just kind of talks about what's happened, a brief history of it. And I tried to keep it as vague as I could, you know, in the style that Games Workshop does, because I don't want to define how everything 100% is in this area and not give other people room to breathe and do what they want in it. So I'm trying to kind of leave it open. There's even a talk about other races in there, so it's not just Tomb Kings. You've got, you know, Chaos is in there, of course. Orcs are in there, Orcs, Ogres, Free People that seem to be a lot like the Bretonians.
Betone. It's fantastic.
Yeah. And other death forces, of course. Flesh Eater Courts and the Abandoned Cities, and, you know, Nagash sending in his vampires to request aid from the Tomb Kings. Basically, they have to say yes, but they don't like to. And then I've got all the rules here. So the first ones I ever made were these, the Time of War rules, because I thought it would be really easy and quick to do. Hopefully this loads.
Yeah, what I like about this, Paul, it's loading real quick, is that you really, in that other denizens, what's cool about using this as a backdrop, and I think this would be a fantastic place to host like a campaign, say, in the upcoming Camp General's handbook, right? Like, you're going to have an ongoing campaign. If you want a place to set it, Tyler's site is a great resource to go to, because there's a home for basically every sort of race and faction in there. You can find a spot in this big desert to play in, so it's super cool.
Yeah, and I may have plans for something along those lines in the future. So we'll see.
It would make a wonderful event.
Yeah, I have plans for lots of things with this website, so it's just kind of seeing what pans out from it. But yeah, I would love to do something like that, and I'm also kind of, you know, I'm cautiously optimistic that Tomb Kings will return in some official capacity, maybe some point in the future. So I'm just kind of waiting to see. I feel like it would happen sooner rather than later. So I don't want to, you know, start up something big and then have it immediately contradicted. But I'm definitely interested in doing something like what you were saying, a campaign set in the Endless Deserts. But yeah, so here are the Time of War rules. Basically the same as what's in the... the same setup as what you see in the campaign books, but for the Endless Deserts, and it has a bunch of different rules for it. And then I also have the War Scrolls, which basically I made these for my Adepticon book because I wanted my Tomb King War Scrolls to look like the ones that everyone else gets to have. So when I made them, I just loaded them all up here so people can use them. I'll let that load while I look at this. So basically I have a War Scroll for everything that I have painted so far in my army, and I'll add in the missing ones as I paint them. But I just tried to make it look as much like an official War Scroll as I could. And I didn't change any rules. Nothing's changed on here. So it's not me creating stuff. The only thing I think I changed was actually on the Skeleton Warriors. I took out the option for the Crypt Shield, the ones that the Vampire Count skeletons have. And that was just because I did not have room on here to include it. I figured, you know, Tomb King players aren't going to take that anyway, so...
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Yeah. Does not belong on a Tomb King army.
And then I've also got some unofficial War Scrolls, which these are the ones that are one that I made myself, just kind of messing around the battalion. Then I also had this one for the Ken of the Monstrous Arcanum that they never made, that Forge World never made. And I actually didn't make this one. I see right there, I'm going to butcher his name, Henan. But he was on the Tomb Kings forum, and he's getting my opinion on how all the rules should be. Oh, it doesn't look like the second page is loading. But and I told him I could host it on this website if you wanted, and I just made it look like the rest of my War Scrolls. So, you know, if anyone else out there wants to create their own War Scroll, either for a battalion or my thing would be ideally bringing back units that didn't make the cut into AOS, send it in to me, you know, and we can put it up here. We can have it on here. And then ability cards were just the command abilities printed out on cards, because I had to use my command abilities and what command abilities were in play. So I decided that I would print these out, and then I could put them next to the so I won't forget.
Yeah, and I will say, watching these in action, because you used these at Adepticon, and they were just like, yeah, so insanely helpful. Because like, you'd watch and be like, oh yeah, okay, cool. Yeah, that guy, that's got that. It just made it so hard to forget that stuff. And I know I'm exactly the one who's like, ah, crap, I put that command ability on there. And you know, you just totally forget, right? Yeah.
Yeah, I forgot. And then, you know, when I'm playing with my friend, it'll always just be like, oh, I forgot to do this. Can I go back? And it'd be fine. But I figured for a tournament, I should try and... this one's not loading either. Vital Objectives was just my take on the tactical objectives from 40K. So this really isn't Tomb King related at all. Beyond the fact that I put little... Which all these illustrations, by the way, are by an illustrator named Kenneth Erickson, that I put up a tweet asking if there's any illustrators out there who would want to help me, and he reached out to me and has done all the 2D illustrations you see on any of this are by him. So, very talented. But this is just a new way to play. Like tactical objectives in 40K, if anyone's familiar with that, makes your game a lot more random, but in a good way. You have to react. And then I'll come back to the battle plan, since that will segue nicely into the scenarios, models, loading.
I've heard there's some really yes, there's some really great Tomb Kings armies up here. At least three out of the four of these are really good. One of them you can probably just skip. It's total garbage.
Yeah, and then we've got this one right here. But you know, I don't know who submitted these models at all, but they just went up today.
I asked who did all this. It's ridiculous. Whoever they are, they should be ashamed of themselves.
But so again, also if anyone wants
too bad they don't have that awesome background display board.
We should have a gallery by Steve Foote. I don't know if you've seen his Tomb Kings.
Yep.
He had the Sobek army, the alligators, the crocodiles. So his stuff should be up here soon. And if there's any other Tomb King players out there that, you know, you've got a nicely painted army you want to display, just send me, get in contact with me, and I'll tell you how to send the pictures to me, and we can put it on here. Or, you know, it doesn't have to be Tomb King related. As long as it's Endless Desert related, it can go up here. All my tutorials, like I said, I've got a map of a small portion of the realm. This is just, you know, a very small section of the Endless Deserts. This is the boundary. Someone already pointed out to me that it's called the Endless Deserts, and right here there's a town called Desert's End. But, you know.
Look. You know, people, it's when you name things, you shoot for the stars, right? I mean, are they saying that they're upset there wasn't truth in advertising? Come on now. I've been to a lot of places.
My background's
greatest coffee. I don't think they were telling the truth either. It's fine.
Yeah, my justification for this is this settlement here was founded by hipsters. And, you know, this one had an ironically named town. So, it's got all the main areas on here, though. And this is also something that I hope to expand as I expand the background for it. It'll move off in one of the directions here and kind of expand outward. Forums. And then, so yeah, the other, books. If you wanted to look at my army list from Adepticon, I have the whole book loaded up here as a PDF that you can scroll through all pages of. A lot of this stuff is already on other parts of the website, like the lore or the war scrolls. But if you want to, you can see it here, how I had it printed out. I just put this up today. It's a short story, part one of a short story. So I hope to write more of this. My goal is to have 10 parts, because apparently that's about the length of the novellas they were doing, but we'll see how that pans out as well. Again, this is some great artwork by Kenneth Erickson that he did for me. Then I also came up with a battle plan. This was the second thing I actually made for the Endless Deserts. And let me open this in a separate window.
And here is exactly what you said. This is a good segue, because like I said, we're going to talk about scenarios. And you were right out there making, you know, this scenario, like you said, very early on. And to me, this is, you know, I've heard it said over and over again. I've said it. The scenarios are where AOS can really shine, right? And it's always, to me, there's just never enough, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I agree completely. So this, I made this, I think the only two books that were out was the main one and Galmaraz. So even though there's like 10 scenarios between those two, I wanted to put something else out there. I mean, of course, now we've got like 100 different scenarios already. But I tried to make it look as much like the official battle plans as I could. The basis of this one is that the attacker has come here to try and recruit the aid of the defender's army, but the defender's not having any of it. So there's rules for ambushing, and basically the victory conditions for this, instead of wiping anyone out, there's a special rule called Listen to Reason, which can replace the attacker's command ability. They have to get into like combat with the enemy general. Their general has to get in combat with the enemy general, and you have to kind of roll to see if you can convince him to listen to you, but you're not allowed to attack him at all if you do that, but he is completely free to attack you as much as he wants. So if your general dies, it passes to another hero, and it keeps going until there's no heroes left. So the victory is if the attacker can succeed in that, and the defender is obviously a victory if they kill the general, kill all the heroes, or wipe out the army. And then I also have some rules in here for a historical fight in between the Stormcast and the Tomb Kings, and this kind of gives you some suggestions saying, like, use the Time of War rules, and all the ambushers should have the reanimate keyword. So it's basically the statues coming to life around them. This is something I wanted to make more of, and I will eventually, but I haven't gotten around to it yet.
It's totally
Tyler,
awesome.
Please tell me you have like a 4x6 foot board of guys or game.
I'm making it. I've got a 2 foot by 2 foot thing with the pyramid on it, and then I've got all the other 2 foot by 2 foot sections and a giant bag of sand and all the paint. And I will have it. Yes.
Wait a minute. Are you telling me you've got a giant bag of peasant sand? This is gonna be a true king, you gotta go out and buy the real sand, the platonic perfection of sand. Buying this normal sand, this corrupted sand. No, that's totally awesome. And yeah, your display board with the pyramid, like you could see in the background of those shots. That's what you saw in the background of those pictures. Is Tyler's like display board that his army shows up on? It is imposing. I would just like to state that. It's great work, man. It's absolutely great work. It's fantastic. So thanks.
Yeah, I made that for Armies on Parade a few years ago.
Nice. And it came out well. And I love that you used the Necropolis, or sorry, the Necrosphinx's wings as like the thing over the top of the pyramid entrance, because of course everybody in the universe has extra sets of Necrosphinx wings because duh. Yeah. All right. So I thought we would transition, since Tyler has written some scenarios and he's played in tournaments, of course, where AOS tournaments where they're using scenarios, and scenarios, as we've said, to me are the lifeblood of the game. So I want to talk about what we all think about scenarios. So let's start at the beginning. What makes a good scenario? What can kill a scenario? What can make it bad? So, Tyler, you're the guest. From what you've seen, from what you've written, you know, can be drawing from what you've read in the books, what you've played in tourneys, what you yourself have created, what is it that to you makes a good scenario, and what makes a bad scenario bad?
Well, to me, what makes a boring scenario anyway is the ones that the victory condition is just kill the enemy. Which Games Workshop was getting away from for a while, but a lot of the ones in God Beast had kill the enemy, wipe out the army, with some, you know, some tweaks in there for how it happened. But to me, that it can either be really easy or it can be really hard depending on the army. If you're playing against me, my, you know, Carrion can just fly up in the sky, my Stalkers can burrow under the ground, pop a corner far away from you. So to me, that just doesn't make an interesting scenario. The ones to me that are really fun to play are the ones that have a either really interesting or inventive objective that you have to achieve. I know a lot of people are a big fan of the ritual from the first book. There's a bunch of other. There was one from the Chaos Dreadhold book, which is actually really cool too, and it's the one for when Vandas Hammerhand goes to get Galmaraz from the Chaos Citadel. The scenario for that is really the ones that give you something else to do that isn't about killing the enemy. And that's also why I created like the Vital Objectives rule set to give. It's kind of a make your own scenario thing, and it you don't even have to. You can lose more models than your enemy, and you can still win doing that as long as you achieve the rest of your objectives.
Yeah, I think you're dead on there. And my thoughts will probably echo much of your own. But Tom, what would you define good and bad as far as scenario goes?
Good is I want some. It needs to be designed in such a way that it is enticing each of the players. They need to feel a tension. The players need to feel a tension between just going out and attacking the enemy and completing the objective. There needs to be competing incentives. Let me say it that way. In my opinion, where I feel a pull where there's advantages to both. If it's just a slaughter fest or a slug fest, just kill the enemy, that's no fun for a variety of reasons. The other thing that, so for me, good is competing objectives. For me, bad is having some new mechanic that's been created kind of wholesale, and it just has each of us like rolling dice to fulfill something that's fairly unrelated to the game and unrelated to conflict in general. I've seen some of these like created scenarios, like go dig for this relic, and it's just based on like a bunch of models are rolling to discover this relic or something like that. Again, a lot, some of these have been fan created or tournament related scenarios, and to me, those are just not as interesting because we're here to fight. So I want there to be fighting, but I want there to be competing objectives for us to for the players to have to make decisions around, tactical decisions around.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. The idea of cross incentives, right? It seems so strange to say, but it's absolutely true. Like, if you think of a victory point mechanic where you get, like, extra victory points for killing the general and for doing this, like, sort of an 8th edition style victory point setup. I have no issue with, like, that kind of battle line kill-kill, all-you-need-is-kill game. I really don't. It's a vitally important scenario to exist, right? Because sometimes that is what I want in my game, to line up and smashy-smash. But if that's the only option or the preeminent option or how most games are played, to me, that's boring, right? And this goes back to, like, I started in 97, late 97, whatever, somewhere in there. Year and a half later, what happens? Mordheim comes out. So, like, very early in my career, I'm playing Mordheim, and we're running every different scenario we can get our hands on, right? Because scenarios, to me, are what kept the same army interesting, and that's really the point, is that, like, you don't need to feel the compulsion to keep changing armies or changing forces if every time your forces have to act in different ways. The same army can be reinvigorated and become interesting again because of the challenges of the scenario. And hence, I'll say two things are to me make it good, and the absence of them makes it bad once we get away from the all-you-need-is-kill. One, randomness. I like some randomness in there. I understand you don't want to just be like all just running around rolling dice. That's fine. I'm not saying that. But there should be some random elements, whether it be terrain features that can explode and cause damage, or like an objective that can walk around or disappear, or, you know, another monster that shows up and acts in a random fashion. There's 1,000 examples, right? I don't care. Pick your poison. But randomness, to me, keeps you having to react. And the second thing is interactivity, right? That when I get there, that myself and the other player should have to interact to get at the thing, right? So that fighting happens almost as a natural emergent property of trying to achieve some of the objectives. Maybe not everyone, but in a lot of the objectives cases, right? So I think those two things, to me, are what define a good scenario, and the absence of them makes it bad. Like, for example, if the scenario is defend, and all that the defender has to do is literally, like, castle in a corner and sit there and not move, and if they hold it for 4 turns, they win or something. Like, I don't care, whatever. If they've got a model standing, I'm not really interested in that scenario, right? Because there's no real interactivity there. There's nothing compelling them. As you said, there's no cross incentives for the defender, right? They just literally sit there and huddle up. And so it just becomes like, okay, well, we knew how this is going to play out. And to me, you know, people talk a lot about using this game as a test of skill. That gets thrown around a lot. To me, there is no better test of skill in your generalship than having to react to competing objectives, to prioritize things, and to random elements that evolve on the table. That's what real war is, right? It's like a commander has to react to these things. And these real competitions of the mind are about, not to me, are to me decided right then and there who can make those better decisions. All right. So that leads right into my next question, because we all know what my answer is for this. I gave you a twofer, but I'm gonna use that what I said to dovetail. Tyler, how much randomness should be in a scenario? I am a fan of, like, a lot, but I have a huge tolerance for it. What do you like as far as randomness goes? What do you think what's the sweet spot?
Yeah, no, I pretty much agree with you. I know a lot of people out there get annoyed with a lot of randomness, and that's why a lot of the people who left AOS left it. But for me, I mean, I liked it. Honestly, 8th edition is what really, really brought me into fantasy, because I felt like it introduced a lot more randomness into the game, whereas 7th edition for me was so much more sterile, and all it was, you could play with, you know, pennies and a ruler and just roll some dice, and it was the same thing. It was all just a game of math whereas 8th edition had the Winds of Magic and all that going on, which I really enjoyed. Yeah, so for me, I like a lot of randomness in it. I don't want the whole game to be random, but you know, I'm primarily playing the game to have fun. So if the randomness plays into the theme of the scenario we're playing, then I'm all for it.
Right on. So not just like literally crazy stuff happening for no reason, but if you're invading lava fields and there are geysers that randomly shoot up, right, or something like that, and maybe like a fire dragon that could roar out and swing by and attack a unit and leave or something, that's an okay level of randomness because it intensifies the experience. Something like that is what you're saying, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yep.
Makes sense. Tom, what about you? But where do you stand on this? I'm interested because I don't know where you're going to fall. You're a very different sort of player often when it comes to this kind of stuff.
Sorry, restate the question.
Where do you fall on the one is no randomness, 10 is crazy thing everywhere. Where do you sit? Where are you planting your flag?
I want randomness. I want to be forced to respond to randomness. I don't want randomness to dictate the game.
Okay.
So
you're saying like
so
a moderate
I would say
level,
like,
right?
Yeah, like 5 to 6 I have no problem with. Because the reality is that I don't want to have made brilliant moves as a general only to have like the game upended because of a single bad die roll. And not a bad die roll like an attack. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about like a, oh, you were in this area, something random happened, oh, your model's removed, or something like that. Like, just random blanket crazy stuff, which happens occasionally in scenarios. So I want randomness. I want it to influence how we respond as players, but I don't want it to control the entire game.
Do you think the key with that is gating the random elements behind choice? Let me explain what I mean. So I think there's two examples that come to my mind. One, I think of the treasure hunt scenario in Mordheim, where you could like you would go and find these like stashes of treasure, and when you turned it over, you would roll a die, and it could be anything from like a monster that was hidden in the trash pile to like a bunch of gold, you know, things you wanted, or a weird stone token, right? But you decided yep. whether or not you interact, who and when you interacted with the trash piles, right? You were never forced
absolutely.
To.
Absolutely, you would choose who you sent to engage.
Yes. Exactly.
Yep.
Or I think about like the Holy War scenario where like you were in an area and in this particular area it would teleport you to a random sixth of the board, right? When you were standing in that area and on a one you never made it, you died, right? So if you didn't want to be teleported, you didn't put in it, you just didn't go to that section, right?
Yep.
So it's an extremely random, dangerous thing, but you're under total control of whether or not you engage with it and who engages
yep.
with it.
Yep, because to me that speaks again. This points back to the general thing, like that's the decision of the player, of the general, to make that call. But if it's being forced upon me, and it's determining the game, that is to me that's less interesting. It can gotcha. Be, and it can downright ruin a game for me.
All right, I dig it. All right, so let's. This time I don't have a good segue, but that's all right. So we already know how I feel about randomness. I like Tom's perspective. I think that's good. I would say I'm even tolerant of a little more. I really don't care. I if dice fall and miniatures die, I'm generally having a good time. But that's Timmy. He loves the random elements. Sure. Absolutely. If there's a coin flipping deck to be had, I'm piloting it. All right. So Tyler, what are you best tournament scenario you've ever played?
I really like the one at Adepticon where it was the capturing scenery. So you had 6 tokens, and you had to basically put down all of your tokens. You could put down 1 token in each piece of scenery, and if at the end of any turn you had all 6 of your tokens down and your opponent had, I think it was 4 or less of his, then you would win. You can't win on the first turn was the only criteria. And the game was just, it was really close because you, your opponent can take away your tokens by moving into base contact with them. You can do the same to theirs. So it was kind of a game of going back and forth in between, trying to not die, trying to take out his stuff, trying to drop your tokens and trying to take away their tokens. Ended up being, I think, the closest game I played at Adepticon. It was always, one of us always had 6 tokens on the board, and the other one had, you know, maybe they had 4, but then on their turn they were able to drop one more, and so then it didn't end. It just, I can't even remember. I think it ended in a draw, because neither of us could get it.
Nice. Nice. Tom, I don't know if you have a pick on this one, but I have a good one. I played it. Oh, go ahead. Go ahead.
No, I don't. Go ahead.
Okay. I played in this was actually back in a previous edition. I don't remember what, but a previous edition. And it was like a Weird Woods scenario type of thing. And so, like, the premise, there were the boards had, like, lots of trees on them. Well, they had things that were woods. As usual for, like, a tournament, it's not like people didn't have that many woods. So some of them were just cut green felt. But in my imagination, they were woods. You get the idea. But the idea was there was, like, monsters in the woods. And so when units that were in the woods suffered, like, massive casualties, which alone wouldn't be very interesting because, like, you just stay out of the woods or, you know, whatever. But what was awesome was the woods would walk around the table, like, in a, like, the, do you remember the piece of terrain you could roll in 8th edition? They were, like, if a magic spell was cast, the woods would, like, get up and walk away, right? So it was that sort of thing. So, like, every round, all of the woods might move, and then you might be positioning your units very carefully of where you're going, and then all of a sudden the woods would just walk on top of you, and then you'd be getting murdered by the monsters in the woods, and suddenly, like, you know, having to suffer all the rules for being inside woods and stuff like that. So it just made it, like, very difficult and challenging to play in, because all your normal strategies are just out the window, right? You could never bank on a unit functioning at optimal sort of power. So there's definitely a bit of luck, but there was certainly still planning to it, because the woods could only move a certain distance. They didn't just, like, run around the board at hyperspeed, right? Like, you could measure how far, you knew the maximum distance a woods could move in the average, so you could, like, you could play that accordingly, right, and sort of, like, bet the angles, because there wasn't that many on the table. So I thought that one was really fun and clever and creative, and I love the idea of, like, awakened woods that walk around and murder people. I think that's fun. Angry trees make me laugh. All right, so here we go. Next question. How, you know, this is something that was always a big point of contention in previous editions, right? How much should scenarios allow for any type of army to succeed, and how much should they penalize certain types of armies, right? You know, there'd be an example of, like, well, this scenario, this type of army is just dead in the water. They can't win it because of rules X, Y, Z. But then at the same time, it'd be like, well, yes, but we want this scenario to penalize gunline armies or something like that, right? So the idea of what is the, what's the middle ground? Is it okay for scenarios not to be friendly to everybody, to all types of armies, and is that maybe even a good thing?
For me, I think that has to be, yeah. You know, if you're going to... Go ahead.
You can go.
I would just say, I think that players need... Go ahead, Tyler. You are the guest.
I was going to say, you know, it depends. If you're playing in, like, a tournament and there's, you know, 5 scenarios or whatever, as long as there's a balance, so it's not one army is penalized the whole scenario, all the scenarios... I think it's fine as long as another type of army is penalized in other ones. Because you want to make scenarios that work for, you know, all-comer lists. We also want to make some scenarios that maybe help more, lean more towards another side. And I guess that would be more if you're trying to put more of a narrative bent on what you're doing. And it definitely helps. But I think it's just about finding a good balance. If you're just doing small scenarios, you probably want to keep it fairly balanced through all of them. But if you're doing larger group of scenarios, like 5 over, you know, a weekend, I think you can afford to throw in 2 or so that favor one style of play over another.
Tom, go ahead. I know you have some thoughts on this as well.
Yeah, I mean, like, my big pushback would be if they're going to do a rule set for that, for anything that is favoring certain styles, having those rule sets be public before coming to the tournament. Like, you don't want to heavily disincentivize a playstyle by surprise. That is a great way to get, to breed a horrible experience for one of your players or multiple tournament goers. And so what I would say is that if you are going to create a scenario where gun lines are basically going to be neutered heavily, I would highly encourage TOs to make those rule sets public before people build their lists.
Yeah, I think you're both dead on. Like, yes, it's okay for certain scenarios to penalize. You wouldn't want it all the time unless there's like something you're really trying to discourage, right? Some horrible skew that you really are trying to push out. And exactly, just make it public. And in fact, if you're trying to de-incentivize behavior, keeping them secret isn't going to do that, right? Like, it doesn't. Nobody wins in that scenario. All right. So, you know, like you've got to, if you really are trying to change behavior, you've got to make it public so that people know how they're supposed to act. If you want it to, and plus by making it public in advance, you can have those ones that are going to penalize individual armies, but still let somebody make that choice because they're like, oh, well, scenario two, you know, is I'm really going to be on the back foot, but I'm willing to take that because scenario one, three, four, and five, I think I'm strong in, right? And let them make that rational sort of decision, and then that also provides them with a really fun challenge in scenario two or whatever, right? Like, there's definitely something to be said for that. Like, that's not a negative thing solely if you see it coming and set yourself up for that experience, right? So it really does turn that frown upside down. I agree. So speaking of like tournament scenarios and stuff like that, and the idea of these five game tourneys or anything like that, could even be what you're doing at home, linked scenarios. How much more, especially with AOS, should we care about linked scenarios? Should we be linking them? Have the consequence of one scenario play directly into the next in some way? Not even necessarily like in your army getting more or less powerful, but just in the idea that maybe even the scenarios are narratively linked, but it could go both directions.
I think it's really narrative. I think it's really good for narrative events and narrative. If you're going for a narrative style of play, it's perfect. I don't know how effective it would be in a more competitive setting, but if you're doing a narrative event, I think, you know, it's perfect for it. As long as you don't want them to influence each other too much, where if they lost the first scenario, basically can't, you know, later on. You want it to influence it, but not decide anything.
Right. Well, it's also tricky at a tourney because generally you're going to pair winners against winners and losers against losers and draws against draws, right? So it's true. Like, you know, it's hard to figure how that, like, the people who are winners, God forbid you're on that middle table that has, like, the one winner paired against the loser where they didn't have an even number. It's like that person rolls in with some massive Benny and the loser has some massive penalty and you're like, oh, now I get to get my teeth kicked in even harder. Great. So, yeah, to me it feels like, And Tom, I didn't mean to just plow over the top of you a bit.
No, go ahead.
To me, it feels like for a tournament play, the right answer is I'd love to see more narratively linked scenarios that are just explaining why one leads into the other, right? Even for any kind of tourney, like, we were doing this, now we're doing this, and there's a reason why B follows after A, right? And they can still be straight games. They don't have to carry over any bonuses or penalties. It could just be like, you know, constructing more of a story around what I'm doing over these 5 days. And I've seen more of that recently. I want to see a lot more of it. Because there's something about it, the same way that you had all your, like, fluff and stuff written up for your army, right? It just makes it more a more immersive experience to me. And then I would love to see more rules beyond sort of what's in the four page of just kind of like, you get this small bonus. I'd love to see more rules like what Materium was running at the end of his 8th edition narrative series on his channel, where, like, the winners and losers of each game got, like, certain small benefits in the overall campaign, right? So I'm really hoping if we don't get that in this General's Handbook, which I don't think we... I think we'll get it to some degree. I would love to see them build on that even more. Because to me, I think that's where the traction comes in, when you get really deep in and invested. What are your thoughts, Tom?
No, I agree.
All right. Easy enough. I like it when you agree. All right. So now the last one. And, you know, this is an interesting one because you talked about your vital objectives, right? And so that's a build off on, like, the 40K. What are those called in 40K? The cards you put up. I don't remember what the name of
tactical objectives.
Oh, yeah, there
you go. I wasn't very creative with my name change. Yeah.
I thought they had some other clever name, but that's clever enough, I guess. So I think that one of the big pitfalls to me that I didn't touch earlier on in bad scenario is, like, over-complexity, right, when you've got too many things going on. So, like, I guess my question here is, how much is too much? And you can answer this however you want, because I understand this is going to be different for different people. But what, when you look at a scenario, what it to you is too much? And maybe you could relate it through, like, a time you played a scenario, right? And it was just like, oh, it was completely overwhelming. It was just too many things going on.
Yeah, I think it's just when there's too much for you to keep track of or remember. And it's a hard, you know, it's different for each person, so that's a hard thing to kind of say, this is when it's too much. But, I mean, when I first started with AOS, when AOS first started, it was really hard for me to remember that each piece of scenery did something. So, on top of whatever objectives were. So just, you know, it comes down to each person. I mean, and that's why I created the ability cards too, because I kept forgetting stuff like that. Basically, you just don't want to make each scenario a task of, like, bookkeeping to be able to play it through to the end. And again, like I said, it's hard. It's different for each person. So if you're playing against one person who's a lot better at it than you, then you can get away with a lot more in it. But I'd say less is more.
Yeah, I definitely agree, Tom. What you're you know, I know you can certainly keep a lot of stuff in your head. You've done this for years, but what do you, Tom? What's your feeling on this? Do you love that super amount of complexity?
No,
oh, nice. All right.
If there are special rules for a scenario, special new things for rolling, new things for terrain, new claim things, it needs to be able to fit in on a note card. Because you got to remember that each of the generals are operating on their own, all of their war scrolls. They're keeping all of that information in their head on both sides. And sometimes they may not be very familiar with the other enemies and what the capabilities are. And so for me, if you're going to introduce new rules, I think it needs to be about a note card. Now, it could be a large note card, but in general, you don't want it too big. And so that's what I would, that would be my default. If the rules are taking an entire print page, you've taken a wrong turn.
Yeah, I mean, I would say I'm more tolerant of the page. But that being said, I feel like, to me, it's a question of this. If you've got if you've got your war scrolls, the more sort of pool choices you're using or scroll allowances or whatever it is, right, the bigger the force, and you know what I mean, right? Like,
yep.
you know what I mean, right? The bigger the force, and then the more terrain you have doing things, right? So if every piece of terrain does something. And then you introduce a scenario that has, like, primary and secondary and tertiary components to it, and it grants new abilities to units, and it has random elements happening. All that is like, you're gonna forget half of that stuff every round. Right? Yep. At that point, you have gone too far. So to me, it's like, go ahead.
I would say, so TOs, if any are watching this, here's my advice. Create for each scenario a note card, like a handout. It could even be a half page, and have one of these, like a bunch printed out for the players, like at the table during each round. Something nice, clean, and if you've gone too far, then, like, if you have more than that, then you've probably gone too far. That's a great litmus test.
Yep. to me, it's like, I like all that stuff. I just don't like all that stuff altogether, right? It's like, I think that the best way to think about this is to think about how you do a mix of that, right? And that's why I've been an advocate of having even different size pool rounds in a tournament, right? Like in, you've got a 15 pool choice tournament or something, right? You got 15 pools, you bring 20, whatever, I don't care. You make 15 choices. You know, round two is only going to use 10, right? Or something like that. Like actually having different pool size choices within the rounds of the tourney. That way you can also then play with the complexity of the scenarios and things like that. To me, that has great value. All right. Cool. Well, I mean, look, I think we've solved the scenario problem. There it is. We've answered it. Tyler, any final thoughts on scenarios? Anything else? Is there anything else you want to design? Like, what do you got your eye on for the next scenario you'd like to add to the Endless Deserts? Have you got any thoughts bouncing around your head?
Well, the next thing I wanted to do originally was a scenario involving the vital objectives rules, kind of focusing them a bit more. Beyond that, I mean, I'm trying to design any scenarios I come up with around kind of a story hook within the deserts themselves. So that's my main concern when it comes to the scenarios, is that I want it to fit the theme, and I want it to... I don't want the victory conditions to be killed the other person. So it's my main concern right there.
No, I like that, and I really agree. There's something much more interesting about a scenario when you kind of like understand why you're doing the things you're doing, right? Like, I don't like a scenario that's literally just completely rulesy, where it's like, there are three objective tokens, you need to touch them and move them to here. Like, you know, like, that can be what's actually happening, but it should be like, you know, there are three crypts and you've got to get in them and take the magical artifacts from them and blah, blah, blah. Like, whatever, I don't care, you know. My point is simply being, let's put some kind of shell around this. It's not that hard, but that little extra, you know, that little extra bit can make a big difference in how you perceive what's going on, especially if you put in just a little bit of extra rules around it to then make it a little more real, right? Like you're raiding crypts for some artifacts, and when you get it out, it actually has an effect because now you have the token and you've got like the magical power of the artifact. It could be a super minor rules effect, but it's something that makes it more real, right? So yeah, I think that's where I'm at. Tom, what are your final thoughts on scenarios?
A well-written scenario can make a game experience. A terribly written one can ruin it. I mean, it can run the entire gamut. So I think that we need to go into this practice of writing scenarios with fear and trembling and lots of playtesting.
Yeah, and I think at the same time, here's what I'll say. I look at, like, the Mordheim community, right, that evolved since the fall of the game was stopped being supported. There's just so many scenarios out there that people have homebrewed, and I've played a ton of them, and some of them are crap, and I just played them once, and I was like, nah, it wasn't very good, and I tossed it aside. But some of them are really good, and I think that's what it is. Like, we just need more, right? Just make a bunch, discard the ones you don't like, keep the ones you like in a regular rotation. Right, and there you go.
Yep.
And I'd love to see some more people create some scenarios. I really would. It's something we've been talking about doing for a while. It's something we kind of have in the works. But I'd love to see more scenarios from everybody, and just kind of thrown out there and all hosted. Like for example, maybe on the Grand Alliance. Maybe some people submit some scenarios to Tyler for the Endless Deserts. Maybe those are then public resources we all have available. I'm just saying. Right, we can all decide our own game experience. That's what I think. All right, so I think with that we've probably reached our time. We'll draw it to a close here. But Tyler, any final thoughts?
Keep checking out the Endless Deserts. I'll update it occasionally. It's not going to be something that's updated like Megalomanitra is updated 3 times a week. It's not going to happen here. This is just meant to be a place for this stuff to live. So as it's created, it will be updated. But just keep an eye out on it. And, yeah, if you want to contribute, There's a contact page on the website with info on how to get a hold of me. Just shoot me an email and let me know how you want to contribute. You know, pictures of your army, scenario ideas, rules ideas, war scroll ideas, whatever. Just let me know.
Awesome. Both his main site, Mingle Miniatures, and The Endless Deserts will be linked down below. Go and check that out. Follow Tyler on Twitter. He's always posting some cool stuff. You can watch he and I get in a ridiculously long and too complex discussion about brushes. That might happen. It might be a thing that happened today. Tom, any final thoughts before we close out for the evening?
Nope.
All right. Thrilling. I will end with this. So, Tyler, Scarlock the Wanderer, formerly All Elves Are Dark, says, not a question, but a statement. Your painting is awesome, all caps, multiple exclamation points. And what he wants to know, and what I want to know, is, Tyler, when are you joining us in the PMP Google Plus community? That's right. We're putting you on the spot right here. We've got the PMP, our hobby-focused Google Plus community, all about making a pledge and painting and showing off your work every month. When are you coming to join us, buddy? Do I need to physically send you the invite? Is that what's happening here?
Yeah, I'm not very good at making painting pledges. Those goals. My painting schedule is about one whole month for a model. So if I'm lucky.
Hey, you're good then. You're gonna fit in real well in the community with a lot of our other members. Believe me, it's fine. Not everybody makes their pledges. Some people just post up what they finish, and not everybody finishes what they pledge, and that's okay too. But I'm just saying, if you see an invite in your email, it might have come from me. All right. To everybody else out there, we thank you very much, as always, for watching. Tyler, absolute pleasure to have you back on the show. We really appreciate it. Like I said, check out his stuff, linked down below. We thank you very much for watching, and as always, we'll see you next Wednesday.